Our words are wise because they are from God, telling of God's wise plan to bring us into the glories of heaven. This plan was hidden in former times, though it was made for our benefit before the world began. But the great men of the world have not understood it. If they had, they never would have crucified the Lord of glory. That is what is meant by the scriptures, which say that no mere man has ever seen, heard, or even imagined what wonderful things God has ready for those who love the Lord. But we know about these things because God has sent His Spirit to tell us. And His Spirit searches out and shows us all of God's deepest secrets. No one can really know what anyone else is thinking or what he is really like, except that person himself. And no one can know God's thoughts except God's own Spirit. And God has actually given us His Spirit, not the world's Spirit, to tell us about the wonderful free gifts of grace and blessing that God has given us. In telling you about these gifts, we have even used the very words given us by the Holy Spirit, not words that we as men might choose. So we use the Holy Spirit's words to explain the Holy Spirit's facts. But the man who isn't a Christian can't understand and can't accept these thoughts from God, which the Holy Spirit teaches us. They sound foolish to him, because only those who have the Holy Spirit within them can understand what the Holy Spirit means. Others just can't take it in. But the spiritual man has insight into everything, and that bothers and baffles the man of the world who can't understand him at all. How could he? For certainly he has never been one to know the Lord's thoughts, or to discuss them with him, or to move the hands of God by prayer. But strange as it seems, we Christians actually do have within us a portion of the very thoughts and mind of Christ.
Chapter 3.
Dear brothers, I have been talking to you as though you were still just babies in the Christian life, who are not following the Lord, but your own desires. I cannot talk to you as I would to healthy Christians who are filled with the Spirit. I have had to feed you with milk and not with solid food, because you couldn't digest anything stronger. And even now, you still have to be fed on milk. For you are still only baby Christians, controlled by your own desires, not God's. When you are jealous of one another and divide up into quarreling groups, doesn't that prove you are still babies, wanting your own way? In fact, you are acting like people who don't belong to the Lord at all. There you are, quarreling about whether I am greater than Apollos and dividing the church. Doesn't this show how little you have grown in the Lord? Who am I, and who is Apollos, that we should be the cause of a quarrel? Why, we're just God's servants. Each of us with certain special abilities, and with our help, you believed. My work was to plant the seed in your hearts, and Apollos' work was to water it. But it was God, not we, who made the garden grow in your hearts. The person who does the planting or watering isn't very important, but God is important because He is the one who makes things grow. Apollos and I are working as a team with the same aim, though each of us will be rewarded for his own hard work. We are only God's co-workers. You are God's garden, not ours. You are God's building, not ours. God in His kindness has taught me how to be an expert builder. I have laid the foundation, and Apollos has built on it. But he who builds on the foundation must be very careful, for no one can ever lay any other real foundation than that one we already have, Jesus Christ. But there are various kinds of materials that can be used to build on that foundation. Some use gold and silver and jewels, and some build with sticks and hay, or even straw. There is going to come a time of testing at Christ's judgment day to see what kind of material each builder has used. Everyone's work will be put through the fire so that all can see whether or not it keeps its value and what was really accomplished. Then, every workman who has built on the foundation with the right materials and whose work still stands will get his pay. But if the house he has built burns up, he will have a great loss. He himself will be saved, but like a man escaping through a wall of flames. Don't you realize that all of you together are the house of God, and that the Spirit of God lives among you in His house? If anyone defiles and spoils God's home, God will destroy him. For God's home is holy and clean, and you are that home. Stop fooling yourselves. If you count yourself above average in intelligence, as judged by this world's standards, you had better put this all aside and be a fool, rather than let it hold you back from the true wisdom from above. For the wisdom of this world is foolishness to God. As it says in the book of Job, God uses man's own brilliance to trap him. He stumbles over his own wisdom and falls. And again, in the book of Psalms, we are told that the Lord knows full well how the human mind reasons and how foolish and futile it is. So don't be proud of following the wise men of this world, for God has already given you everything you need. He has given you Paul and Apollos and Peter as your helpers. He has given you the whole world to use, and life and even death are your servants. He has given you all of the present and all of the future. All are yours, and you belong to Christ, and Christ is God's.
Chapter 4.
So Apollos and I should be looked upon as Christ's servants, who distribute God's blessings by explaining God's secrets. Now, the most important thing about a servant is that he does just what his master tells him to. What about me? Have I been a good servant? Well, I don't worry over what you think about this or what anyone else thinks. I don't even trust my own judgment on this point. My conscience is clear, but even that isn't final proof. It is the Lord himself who must examine me and decide. So be careful not to jump to conclusions before the Lord returns as to whether someone is a good servant or not. When the Lord comes, he will turn on the light so that everyone can see exactly what each one of us is really like, deep down in our hearts. Then everyone will know why we have been doing the Lord's work. At that time, God will give to each one whatever praise is coming to him. I have used Apollos and myself as examples to illustrate what I've been saying, that you must not have favorites. You must not be proud of one of God's teachers more than another. What are you so puffed up about? What do you have that God hasn't given you? And if all you have is from God, why act as though you are so great, and as though you have accomplished something on your own? You seem to think you already have all the spiritual food you need. You are full and spiritually contented, rich kings on your thrones, leaving us far behind. I wish you really were already on your thrones, for when that time comes, you can be sure that we will be there too, reigning with you. Sometimes I think God has put us apostles at the very end of the line, like prisoners, soon to be killed, put on display at the end of a victor's parade, to be stared at by men and angels alike. Religion has made us foolish, you say. But of course you are all such wise and sensible Christians. We are weak, but not you. You are well thought of, while we are laughed at. To this very hour, we have gone hungry and thirsty, without even enough clothes to keep us warm. We have been kicked around without homes of our own. We have worked wearily with our hands to earn our living. We have blessed those who cursed us. We have been patient with those who injured us. We have replied quietly when evil things have been said about us. Yet right up to the present moment, we are like dirt underfoot, like garbage. I am not writing about these things to make you ashamed, but to warn and counsel you as beloved children. For although you may have 10,000 others to teach you about Christ, remember that you have only me as your father. For I was the one who brought you to Christ when I preached the gospel to you. So I beg you to follow my example and do as I do. That is the very reason why I am sending Timothy, to help you do this. For he is one of those I won to Christ, a beloved and trustworthy child in the Lord. He will remind you of what I teach in all the churches wherever I go. I know that some of you will have become proud, thinking that I am afraid to come to deal with you. But I will come, and soon, if the Lord will let me. And then I'll find out whether these proud men are just big talkers, or whether they really have God's power. The kingdom of God is not just talking. It is living by God's power. Which do you choose? Shall I come with punishment and scolding? Or shall I come with quiet love and gentleness?
Chapter 5.
Everyone is talking about the terrible thing that has happened there among you. something so evil that even the heathen don't do it. You have a man in your church who is living in sin with his father's wife. And are you still so conceited, so spiritual? Why aren't you mourning in sorrow and shame and seeing to it that this man is removed from your membership? Although I am not there with you, I have been thinking a lot about this. And in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I have already decided what to do, just as though I were there. You are to call a meeting of the church, and the power of the Lord Jesus will be with you as you meet, and I will be there in spirit. And cast out this man from the fellowship of the church and into Satan's hands to punish him, in the hope that his soul will be saved when our Lord Jesus Christ returns. What a terrible thing it is that you are boasting about your purity, and yet you let this sort of thing go on. Don't you realize that if even one person is allowed to go on sinning, soon all will be affected? Remove this evil cancer, this wicked person from among you, so that you can stay pure. Christ, God's Lamb, has been slain for us. So let us feast upon him and grow strong in the Christian life, leaving entirely behind us the cancerous old life with all its hatreds and wickedness. Let us feast instead upon the pure bread of honor and sincerity and truth. When I wrote to you before, I said not to mix with evil people. But when I said that, I wasn't talking about unbelievers who live in sexual sin or are greedy cheats and thieves and idol worshippers. For you can't live in this world without being with people like that. What I meant was that you are not to keep company with anyone who claims to be a brother Christian, but indulges in sexual sins, or is greedy, or is a swindler, or worships idols, or is a drunkard or abusive. Don't even eat lunch with such a person. It isn't our job to judge outsiders, but it certainly is our job to judge and deal strongly with those who are members of the church and who are sinning in these ways. God alone is the judge of those on the outside, but you yourselves must deal with this man and put him out of your church.
Chapter 6.
How is it that when you have something against another Christian, you go to law and ask a heathen court to decide the matter instead of taking it to other Christians to decide which of you is right? Don't you know that someday we Christians are going to judge and govern the world? So why can't you decide even these little things among yourselves? Don't you realize that we Christians will judge and reward the very angels in heaven? So you should be able to decide your problems down here on earth easily enough. Why then go to outside judges who are not even Christians? I am trying to make you ashamed. Isn't there anyone in all the church who is wise enough to decide these arguments? But instead, one Christian sues another and accuses his Christian brother in front of unbelievers. To have such lawsuits at all is a real defeat for you as Christians. Why not just accept mistreatment and leave it at that? It would be far more honoring to the Lord to let yourselves be cheated. But instead, you yourselves are the ones who do wrong, cheating others, even your own brothers. Don't you know that those doing such things have no share in the kingdom of God? Don't fool yourselves. Those who live immoral lives, who are idol worshippers, adulterers, or homosexuals, will have no share in his kingdom. Neither will thieves or greedy people, drunkards, slandermongers, or robbers. There was a time when some of you were just like that. But now your sins are washed away, and you are set apart for God, and he has accepted you because of what the Lord Jesus Christ and the Spirit of our God have done for you. I can do anything I want to if Christ has not said no, but some of these things aren't good for me. Even if I am allowed to do them, I'll refuse to if I think they might get such a grip on me that I can't easily stop when I want to. For instance, take the matter of eating. God has given us an appetite for food and stomachs to digest it. But that doesn't mean we should eat more than we need. Don't think of eating as important, because someday God will do away with both stomachs and food. But sexual sin is never right. Our bodies were not made for that, but for the Lord. And the Lord wants to fill our bodies with himself. And God is going to raise our bodies from the dead by his power, just as he raised up the Lord Jesus Christ. Don't you realize that your bodies are actually parts and members of Christ? So should I take part of Christ and join him to a prostitute? Never. And don't you know that if a man joins himself to a prostitute, she becomes a part of him and he becomes a part of her? For God tells us in the Scripture that in his sight the two become one person. But if you give yourself to the Lord, you and Christ are joined together as one person. That is why I say to run from sex sin. No other sin affects the body as this one does. When you sin this sin, it is against your own body. Haven't you yet learned that your body is the home of the Holy Spirit God gave you, and that he lives within you? Your own body does not belong to you, for God has bought you with a great price. So use every part of your body to give glory back to God, because he owns it.
Chapter 7.
Now about those questions you asked in your last letter. My answer is that if you do not marry, it is good. But usually it is best to be married, each man having his own wife and each woman having her own husband, because otherwise you might fall back into sin. The man should give his wife all that is her right as a married woman, and the wife should do the same for her husband. For a girl who marries no longer has full right to her own body, for her husband then has his rights to it too. And in the same way, the husband no longer has full right to his own body, for it belongs also to his wife. So do not refuse these rights to each other. The only exception to this rule would be the agreement of both husband and wife to refrain from the rights of marriage for a limited time so that they can give themselves more completely to prayer. Afterwards, they should come together again so that Satan won't be able to tempt them because of their lack of self-control. I'm not saying you must marry, but you certainly may if you wish. I wish everyone could get along without marrying, just as I do, but we are not all the same. God gives some the gift of a husband or wife, and others he gives the gift of being able to stay happily unmarried. So I say to those who aren't married and to widows, better to stay unmarried if you can, just as I am. But if you can't control yourselves, go ahead and marry. It is better to marry than to burn with lust. Now for those who are married, I have a command, not just a suggestion. And it is not a command from me, for this is what the Lord himself has said. A wife must not leave her husband. But if she is separated from him, let her remain single or else go back to him. And the husband must not divorce his wife. Here I want to add some suggestions of my own. These are not direct commands from the Lord, but they seem right to me. If a Christian has a wife who is not a Christian, but she wants to stay with him anyway, he must not leave her or divorce her. And if a Christian woman has a husband who isn't a Christian, and he wants her to stay with him, she must not leave him. For perhaps the husband who isn't a Christian may become a Christian with the help of his Christian wife, and the wife who isn't a Christian may become a Christian with the help of her Christian husband. Otherwise, if the family separates, the children might never come to know the Lord. Whereas a united family may, in God's plan, result in the children's salvation. But if the husband or wife who isn't a Christian is eager to leave, it is permitted. In such cases, the Christian husband or wife should not insist that the other stay, for God wants his children to live in peace and harmony. For after all, there is no assurance to you wives that your husbands will be converted if they stay, and the same may be said to you husbands concerning your wives. But be sure in deciding these matters that you are living as God intended, marrying or not marrying in accordance with God's direction and help, and accepting whatever situation God has put you into. This is my rule for all the churches. For instance, a man who already has gone through the Jewish ceremony of circumcision before he became a Christian shouldn't worry about it. And if he hasn't been circumcised, he shouldn't do it now. For it doesn't make any difference at all whether a Christian has gone through this ceremony or not. But it makes a lot of difference whether he is pleasing God and keeping God's commandments. That is the important thing. Usually a person should keep on with the work he was doing when God called him. Are you a slave? Don't let that worry you. But of course if you get a chance to be free, take it. If the Lord calls you and you are a slave, remember that Christ has set you free from the awful power of sin. And if he has called you and you are free, remember that you are now a slave of Christ. You have been bought and paid for by Christ, so you belong to him. Be free now from all these earthly prides and fears. So, dear brothers, whatever situation a person is in when he becomes a Christian, let him stay there, for now the Lord is there to help him. Now I will try to answer your other question. What about girls who are not yet married? Should they be permitted to do so? In answer to this question, I have no special command for them from the Lord, but the Lord in His kindness has given me wisdom that can be trusted, and I will be glad to tell you what I think. Here is the problem. We Christians are facing great dangers to our lives at present. In times like these, I think it is best for a person to remain unmarried. Of course, if you already are married, don't separate because of this. But if you aren't, don't rush into it at this time. But if you men decide to go ahead anyway and get married now, it is all right. And if a girl gets married in times like these, it is no sin. However, marriage will bring extra problems that I wish you didn't have to face right now. The important thing to remember is that our remaining time is very short, and so are our opportunities for doing the Lord's work. For that reason, those who have wives should stay as free as possible for the Lord. Happiness or sadness or wealth should not keep anyone from doing God's work. Those in frequent contact with the exciting things the world offers should make good use of their opportunities without stopping to enjoy them, for the world in its present form will soon be gone. In all you do, I want you to be free from worry. An unmarried man can spend his time doing the Lord's work and thinking how to please Him, but a married man can't do that so well. He has to think about his earthly responsibilities and how to please his wife. His interests are divided. It is the same with a girl who marries. She faces the same problem. A girl who is not married is anxious to please the Lord in all she is and does. But a married woman must consider other things, such as housekeeping and the likes and dislikes of her husband. I am saying this to help you, not to try to keep you from marrying. I want you to do whatever will help you serve the Lord best, with as few other things as possible to distract your attention from Him. But if anyone feels he ought to marry because he has trouble controlling his passions, it is all right. It is not a sin. Let him marry. But if a man has the willpower not to marry and decides that he doesn't need to and won't, he has made a wise decision. So the person who marries does well, and the person who doesn't marry does even better. The wife is part of her husband as long as he lives. If her husband dies, then she may marry again, but only if she marries a Christian. But in my opinion, she will be happier if she doesn't marry again. And I think I am giving you counsel from God's Spirit when I say this.
Chapter 8.
Next is your question about eating food that has been sacrificed to idols. On this question, everyone feels that only his answer is the right one. But although being a know-it-all makes us feel important, what is really needed to build the church is love. If anyone thinks he knows all the answers, he is just showing his ignorance. But the person who truly loves God is the one who is open to God's knowledge. So now, what about it? Should we eat meat that has been sacrificed to idols? Well, we all know that an idol is not really a god, and that there is only one God and no other. According to some people, there are a great many gods, both in heaven and on earth. But we know that there is only one God, the Father, who created all things and made us to be His own, and one Lord, Jesus Christ, who made everything and gives us life. However, some Christians don't realize this. All their lives, they have been used to thinking of idols as alive, and have believed that food offered to the idols is really being offered to actual gods. So when they eat such food, it bothers them and hurts their tender consciences. Just remember that God doesn't care whether we eat it or not. We are no worse off if we don't eat it, and no better off if we do. But be careful not to use your freedom to eat it, lest you cause some Christian brother to sin, whose conscience is weaker than yours. You see, this is what may happen. Someone who thinks it is wrong to eat this food will see you eating at a temple restaurant, for you know there is no harm in it. Then he will become bold enough to do it too, although all the time he still feels it is wrong. So because you know it is all right to do it, you will be responsible for causing great spiritual damage to a brother with a tender conscience for whom Christ died. And it is a sin against Christ to sin against your brother by encouraging him to do something he thinks is wrong. So if eating meat offered to idols is going to make my brother sin, I'll not eat any of it as long as I live, because I don't want to do this to him.
Chapter 9.
I am an apostle, God's messenger, responsible to no mere man. I am one who has actually seen Jesus, our Lord, with my own eyes. And your changed lives are the result of my hard work for him. If, in the opinion of others, I am not an apostle, I certainly am to you, for you have been won to Christ through me. This is my answer to those who question my rights. Or don't I have any rights at all? Can't I claim the same privilege the other apostles have of being a guest in your homes? If I had a wife, and if she were a believer, couldn't I bring her along on these trips just as the other disciples do, and as the Lord's brothers do, and as Peter does? And must Barnabas and I alone keep working for our living while you supply these others? What soldier in the army has to pay his own expenses? And have you ever heard of a farmer who harvests his crop and doesn't have the right to eat some of it? What shepherd takes care of a flock of sheep and goats and isn't allowed to drink some of the milk? And I'm not merely quoting the opinions of men as to what is right. I'm telling you what God's law says. For in the law God gave to Moses, he said that you must not put a muzzle on an ox to keep it from eating when it is treading out the wheat. Do you suppose God was thinking only about oxen when he said this? Wasn't he also thinking about us? Of course he was. He said this to show us that Christian workers should be paid by those they help. Those who do the plowing and threshing should expect some share of the harvest. We have planted good spiritual seed in your souls. Is it too much to ask in return for mere food and clothing? You give them to others who preach to you, and you should. But shouldn't we have an even greater right to them? Yet we have never used this right, but supply our own needs without your help. We have never demanded payment of any kind for fear that if we did, you might be less interested in our message to you from Christ. Don't you realize that God told those working in his temple to take for their own needs some of the food brought there as gifts to him? And those who work at the altar of God get a share of the food that is brought by those offering it to the Lord. In the same way, the Lord has given orders that those who preach the gospel should be supported by those who accept it. Yet I have never asked you for one penny, and I am not writing this to hint that I would like to start now. In fact, I would rather die of hunger than lose the satisfaction I get from preaching to you without charge. For just preaching the gospel isn't any special credit to me. I couldn't keep from preaching it if I wanted to. I would be utterly miserable. Woe unto me if I don't. If I were volunteering my services of my own free will, then the Lord would give me a special reward. But that is not the situation, for God has picked me out and given me this sacred trust, and I have no choice. Under this circumstance, what is my pay? It is the special joy I get from preaching the good news without expense to anyone, never demanding my rights. And this has a real advantage. I am not bound to obey anyone just because he pays my salary. Yet I have freely and happily become a servant of any and all so that I can win them to Christ. When I am with the Jews, I seem as one of them so that they will listen to the gospel and I can win them to Christ. When I am with Gentiles who follow Jewish customs and ceremonies, I don't argue, even though I don't agree, because I want to help them. When with the heathen, I agree with them as much as I can, except, of course, that I must always do what is right as a Christian. And so, by agreeing, I can win their confidence and help them, too. When I am with those whose consciences bother them easily, I don't act as though I know it all and don't say they are foolish. The result is that they are willing to let me help them. Yes, whatever a person is like, I try to find common ground with him so that he will let me tell him about Christ and let Christ save him. I do this to get the gospel to them and also for the blessing I myself receive when I see them come to Christ. In a race, everyone runs, but only one person gets first prize. So run your race to win. To win the contest, you must deny yourselves many things that would keep you from doing your best. An athlete goes to all this trouble just to win a blue ribbon or a silver cup. But we do it for a heavenly reward that never disappears. So I run straight to the goal with purpose in every step. I fight to win. I'm not just shadow boxing or playing around. Like an athlete, I punish my body, treating it roughly, training it to do what it should, not what it wants to. Otherwise, I fear that after enlisting others for the race, I myself might be declared unfit and ordered to stand aside.
Chapter 10.
For we must never forget, dear brothers, what happened to our people in the wilderness long ago. God guided them by sending a cloud that moved along ahead of them, and he brought them all safely through the waters of the Red Sea. This might be called their baptism, baptized both in sea and cloud as followers of Moses, their commitment to him as their leader. And by a miracle, God sent them food to eat and water to drink there in the desert. They drank the water that Christ gave them. He was there with them as a mighty rock of spiritual refreshment. Yet after all this, most of them did not obey God, and he destroyed them in the wilderness. From this lesson, we are warned that we must not desire evil things as they did, nor worship idols as they did. The scriptures tell us the people sat down to eat and drink and then got up to dance in worship of the golden calf. Another lesson for us is what happened when some of them sinned with other men's wives and 23,000 fell dead in one day. And don't try the Lord's patience. They did and died from snake bites. And don't murmur against God and his dealings with you as some of them did. For that is why God sent his angel to destroy them. All these things happen to them as examples, as object lessons to us, to warn us against doing the same things. They were written down so that we could read about them and learn from them in these last days as the world nears its end. So be careful. If you are thinking, oh, I would never behave like that, let this be a warning to you, for you too may fall into sin. But remember this, the wrong desires that come into your life aren't anything new and different. Many others have faced exactly the same problems before you, and no temptation is irresistible. You can trust God to keep the temptation from becoming so strong that you can't stand up against it, for he has promised this and will do what he says. He will show you how to escape temptation's power so that you can bear up patiently against it. So, dear friends, carefully avoid idol worship of every kind. You are intelligent people. Look now and see for yourselves whether what I am about to say is true. When we ask the Lord's blessing upon our drinking from the cup of wine at the Lord's table, this means, doesn't it, that all who drink it are sharing together the blessing of Christ's blood. And when we break off pieces of the bread from the loaf to eat there together, this shows that we are sharing together in the benefits of his body. No matter how many of us there are, we all eat from the same loaf, showing that we are all parts of the one body of Christ. And the Jewish people, all who eat the sacrifices, are united by that act. What am I trying to say? Am I saying that the idols to whom the heathen bring sacrifices are really alive and are real gods, and that these sacrifices are of some value? No. Not at all. What I am saying is that those who offer food to these idols are united together in sacrificing to demons, certainly not to God. And I don't want any of you to be partners with demons when you eat the same food along with the heathen that has been offered to these idols. You cannot drink from the cup at the Lord's table and at Satan's table too. You cannot eat bread both at the Lord's table and at Satan's table. What? Are you tempting the Lord to be angry with you? Are you stronger than he is? You are certainly free to eat food offered to idols if you want to. It's not against God's laws to eat such meat. But that doesn't mean that you should go ahead and do it. It may be perfectly legal, but it may not be best and helpful. Don't think only of yourself. Try to think of the other fellow, too, and what is best for him. Here's what you should do. Take any meat you want that is sold at the market. Don't ask whether or not it was offered to idols.
lest the answer hurt your conscience. For the earth and every good thing in it belongs to the Lord and is yours to enjoy. If someone who isn't a Christian asks you out to dinner, go ahead. Accept the invitation if you want to. Eat whatever is on the table and don't ask any questions about it. Then you won't know whether or not it had been used as a sacrifice to idols, and you won't risk having a bad conscience over eating it. But if someone warns you that this meat has been offered to idols, then don't eat it for the sake of the man who told you and of his conscience. In this case, his feeling about it is the important thing, not yours. But why, you may ask, must I be guided and limited by what someone else thinks? If I can thank God for the food and enjoy it, why let someone spoil everything just because he thinks I am wrong? Well, I'll tell you why. It is because you must do everything for the glory of God, even your eating and drinking. So don't be a stumbling block to anyone, whether they are Jews or Gentiles or Christians. That is the plan I follow, too. I try to please everyone in everything I do, not doing what I like or what is best for me, but what is best for them, so that they may be saved.
Chapter 11.
And you should follow my example, just as I follow Christ's. I am so glad, dear brothers, that you have been remembering and doing everything I taught you. But there is one matter I want to remind you about. That a wife is responsible to her husband. Her husband is responsible to Christ, and Christ is responsible to God. That is why, if a man refuses to remove his hat while praying or preaching, he dishonors Christ. And that is why a woman who publicly prays or prophesies without a covering on her head dishonors her husband, for her covering is a sign of her subjection to him. Yes, if she refuses to wear a head covering, then she should cut off all her hair. And if it is shameful for a woman to have her head shaved, then she should wear a covering. But a man should not wear anything on his head when worshiping, for his hat is a sign of subjection to men. God's glory is man, made in his image, and man's glory is the woman. The first man didn't come from woman, but the first woman came out of man. And Adam, the first man, was not made for Eve's benefit, but Eve was made for Adam. So a woman should wear a covering on her head as a sign that she is under man's authority, a fact for all the angels to notice and rejoice in. But remember that in God's plan, men and women need each other. For although the first woman came out of man, all men have been born from women ever since, and both men and women come from God, their Creator. What do you yourselves really think about this? Is it right for a woman to pray in public without covering her head? Doesn't even instinct itself teach us that women's heads should be covered? For women are proud of their long hair, while a man with long hair tends to be ashamed. But if anyone wants to argue about this, all I can say is that we never teach anything else than this, that a woman should wear a covering when prophesying or praying publicly in the church, and all the churches feel the same way about it. Next on my list of items to write you about is something else I cannot agree with, for it sounds as if more harm than good is done when you meet together for your communion services. Everyone keeps telling me about the arguing that goes on in these meetings, and the divisions developing among you, and I can just about believe it. But I suppose you feel this is necessary so that you who are always right will become known and recognized. When you come together to eat, it isn't the Lord's Supper you're eating, but your own. For I am told that everyone hastily gobbles all the food he can without waiting to share with the others, so that one doesn't get enough and goes hungry, while another has too much to drink and gets drunk. What, is this really true? Can't you do your eating and drinking at home to avoid disgracing the church and shaming those who are poor and can bring no food? What am I supposed to say about these things? Do you want me to praise you? Well, I certainly do not, for this is what the Lord himself has said about his table, and I have passed it on to you before, that on the night when Judas betrayed him, the Lord Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks to God for it, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take this and eat it. This is my body which is given for you. Do this to remember me." In the same way, he took the cup of wine after supper, saying, "This cup is the new agreement between God and you that has been established and set in motion by my blood. Do this in remembrance of me whenever you drink it. For every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you are retelling the message of the Lord's death, that he has died for you. Do this until he comes again. So if anyone eats this bread and drinks from this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner, he is guilty of sin against the body and the blood of the Lord. That is why a man should examine himself carefully before eating the bread and drinking from the cup. For if he eats the bread and drinks from the cup unworthily, not thinking about the body of Christ and what it means, he is eating and drinking God's judgment upon himself, for he is trifling with the death of Christ. That is why many of you are weak and sick, and some have even died. But if you carefully examine yourselves before eating, you will not need to be judged and punished. Yet when we are judged and punished by the Lord, it is so that we will not be condemned with the rest of the world. So, dear brothers, when you gather for the Lord's Supper, the communion service, wait for each other. If anyone is really hungry, he should eat at home so that he won't bring punishment upon himself when you meet together. I'll talk to you about the other matters after I arrive.
Chapter 12.
And now, brothers, I want to write about the special abilities the Holy Spirit gives to each of you, for I don't want any misunderstanding about them. You will remember that before you became Christians, you went around from one idol to another, not one of which could speak a single word. But now you are meeting people who claim to speak messages from the Spirit of God. How can you know whether they are really inspired by God, or whether they are fakes? Here is the test. No one speaking by the power of the Spirit of God can curse Jesus. And no one can say Jesus is Lord and really mean it, unless the Holy Spirit is helping him. Now, God gives us many kinds of special abilities, but it is the same Holy Spirit who is the source of them all. There are different kinds of service to God, but it is the same Lord we are serving. There are many ways in which God works in our lives, but it is the same God who does the work in and through all of us who are his. The Holy Spirit displays God's power through each of us as a means of helping the entire church.
If I had the gift of prophecy and knew all about what is going to happen in the future, knew everything about everything, but didn't love others, what good would it do? Even if I had the gift of faith so that I could speak to a mountain and make it move, I would still be worth nothing at all without love. If I gave everything I have to poor people, and if I were burned alive for preaching the gospel but didn't love others, it would be of no value whatever. Love is very patient and kind, never jealous or envious, never boastful or proud, never haughty or selfish or rude. Love does not demand its own way. It is not irritable or touchy. It does not hold grudges and will hardly even notice when others do it wrong. It is never glad about injustice, but rejoices whenever truth wins out. If you love someone, you will be loyal to him, no matter what the cost. You will always believe in him, always expect the best of him, and always stand your ground in defending him. All the special gifts and powers from God will someday come to an end, but love goes on forever. Someday, prophecy and speaking in unknown languages and special knowledge, these gifts will disappear. Now we know so little, even with our special gifts, and the preaching of those most gifted is still so poor. But when we have been made perfect and complete, then the need for these inadequate special gifts will come to an end, and they will disappear. It's like this. When I was a child, I spoke and thought and reasoned as a child does. But when I became a man, my thoughts grew far beyond those of my childhood. and now I have put away the childish things. In the same way, we can see and understand only a little about God now, as if we were peering at his reflection in a poor mirror. But someday, we are going to see him in his completeness, face to face. Now all that I know is hazy and blurred. But then, I will see everything clearly, just as clearly as God sees into my heart right now. There are three things that remain: faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these is love.
Chapter 14.
Let love be your greatest aim. Nevertheless, ask also for the special abilities the Holy Spirit gives, and especially the gift of prophecy, being able to preach the messages of God. But if your gift is that of being able to speak in tongues, that is, to speak in languages you haven't learned, you will be talking to God, but not to others, since they won't be able to understand you. You will be speaking by the power of the Spirit, but it will all be a secret. But one who prophesies, preaching the messages of God, is helping others grow in the Lord, encouraging and comforting them. So a person speaking in tongues helps himself grow spiritually, but one who prophesies, preaching messages from God, helps the entire church grow in holiness and happiness. I wish you all had the gift of speaking in tongues, but even more, I wish you were all able to prophesy, preaching God's messages, for that is a greater and more useful power than to speak in unknown languages. Unless, of course, you can tell everyone afterwards what you are saying, so that they can get some good out of it, too. Dear friends, even if I myself should come to you talking in some language you don't understand, how would that help you? But if I speak plainly what God has revealed to me, and tell you the things I know, and what is going to happen, and the great truths of God's Word, that is what you need. That is what will help you. Even musical instruments, the flute, for instance, or the harp, are examples of the need for speaking in plain, simple English, rather than in unknown languages. For no one will recognize the tune the flute is playing unless each note is sounded clearly. And if the army bugler doesn't play the right notes, how will the soldiers know that they are being called to battle? In the same way, if you talk to a person in some language he doesn't understand, how will he know what you mean? You might as well be talking to an empty room. I suppose that there are hundreds of different languages in the world, and all are excellent for those who understand them, but to me they mean nothing. A person talking to me in one of these languages will be a stranger to me, and I will be a stranger to him. Since you are so anxious to have special gifts from the Holy Spirit, ask him for the very best, for those that will be of real help to the whole church. If someone is given the gift of speaking in unknown tongues, he should pray also for the gift of knowing what he has said, so that he can tell people afterwards, plainly. For if I pray in a language I don't understand, my spirit is praying, but I don't know what I am saying. Well then, what shall I do? I will do both. I will pray in unknown tongues and also in ordinary language, that everyone understands. I will sing in unknown tongues and also in ordinary language, so that I can understand the praise I am giving. For if you praise and thank God with the Spirit alone, speaking in another language, how can those who don't understand you be praising God along with you? How can they join you in giving thanks when they don't know what you are saying? You will be giving thanks very nicely, no doubt, but the other people present won't be helped. I thank God that I speak in tongues privately more than any of the rest of you. But in public worship, I would much rather speak 5 words that people can understand and be helped by than 10,000 words while speaking in tongues in an unknown language. Dear brothers, don't be childish in your understanding of these things. Be innocent babies when it comes to planning evil, but be men of intelligence in understanding matters of this kind. We are told in the ancient scriptures that God would send men from other lands to speak in foreign languages to his people, but even then they would not listen. So you see that being able to speak in tongues is not a help to God's children, but is to interest the unsaved. However, prophecy, preaching the deep truths of God, is what the Christians need, and unbelievers aren't yet ready for it. Even so, if an unsaved person or someone who doesn't have these gifts comes to church and hears you all talking in other languages, he is likely to think you are crazy. But if you prophesy, preaching God's word, even though such preaching is mostly for believers, and an unsaved person or a new Christian comes in who does not understand about these things, all these sermons will convince him of the fact that he is a sinner, and his conscience will be pricked by everything he hears. As he listens, his secret thoughts will be laid bare, and he will fall down on his knees and worship God, declaring that God is really there among you. Well, my brothers, let's add up what I am saying. When you meet together, some will sing, another will teach, or tell some special information God has given him, or speak in an unknown language, or tell what someone else is saying who is speaking in the unknown language. But everything that is done must be useful to all and build them up in the Lord. No more than two or three should speak in an unknown language, and they must speak one at a time, and someone must be ready to interpret what they are saying. But if no one is present who can interpret, they must not speak out loud. They must talk silently to themselves and to God in the unknown language, but not publicly. Two or three may prophesy, one at a time if they have the gift, while all the others listen. But if while someone is prophesying, someone else receives a message or idea from the Lord, the one who is speaking should stop. In this way, all who have the gift of prophecy can speak, one after the other, and everyone will learn and be encouraged and helped. Remember that a person who has a message from God has the power to stop himself or wait his turn. God is not one who likes things to be disorderly and upset. He likes harmony, and he finds it in all the other churches. Women should be silent during the church meetings. They are not to take part in the discussion, for they are subordinate to men, as the scriptures also declare. If they have any questions to ask, let them ask their husbands at home, for it is improper for women to express their opinions in church meetings. You disagree? And do you think that the knowledge of God's will begins and ends with you Corinthians? Well, you are mistaken. You who claim to have the gift of prophecy or any other special ability from the Holy Spirit should be the first to realize that what I am saying is a commandment from the Lord himself. But if anyone still disagrees, well, we will leave him in his ignorance. So, my fellow believers, long to be prophets, so that you can preach God's message plainly, and never say it is wrong to speak in tongues. However, be sure that everything is done properly, in a good and orderly way.
Chapter 15.
Now let me remind you, brothers, of what the gospel really is, for it has not changed. It is the same good news I preached to you before. You welcomed it then, and still do now, for your faith is squarely built upon this wonderful message. And it is this good news that saves you if you still firmly believe it, unless, of course, you never really believed it in the first place. I passed on to you right from the first what had been told to me, that Christ died for our sins, just as the scriptures said he would, and that he was buried, and that 3 days afterwards he arose from the grave, just as the prophets foretold. He was seen by Peter, and later by the rest of the 12. After that, he was seen by more than 500 Christian brothers at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died by now. Then James saw him, and later all the apostles. Last of all, I saw him too, long after the others, as though I had been born almost too late for this. For I am the least worthy of all the apostles, and I shouldn't even be called an apostle at all after the way I treated the church of God. But whatever I am now, it is all because God poured out such kindness and grace upon me, and not without results. For I have worked harder than all the other apostles, yet actually I wasn't doing it, but God working in me to bless me. It makes no difference who worked the hardest, I or they. The important thing is that we preached the gospel to you, and you believed it. But tell me this, since you believe what we preach, that Christ rose from the dead, why are some of you saying that dead people will never come back to life again? For if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ must still be dead. And if he is still dead, then all our preaching is useless, and your trust in God is empty, worthless, hopeless. And we apostles are all liars, because we have said that God raised Christ from the grave. And of course that isn't true if the dead do not come back to life again. If they don't, then Christ is still dead. And you are very foolish to keep on trusting God to save you, and you are still under condemnation for your sins. In that case, all Christians who have died are lost. And if being a Christian is of value to us only now in this life, we are the most miserable of creatures. But the fact is that Christ did actually rise from the dead and has become the first of millions who will come back to life again someday. Death came into the world because of what one man, Adam, did. And it is because of what this other man, Christ, has done that now there is the resurrection from the dead. Everyone dies because all of us are related to Adam, being members of his sinful race. And wherever there is sin, death results. But all who are related to Christ will rise again, each, however, in his own turn. Christ rose first, then when Christ comes back, all his people will become alive again. After that, the end will come when he will turn the kingdom over to God the Father, having put down all enemies of every kind. For Christ will be king until he has defeated all his enemies, including the last enemy, death. This too must be defeated and ended. For the rule and authority over all things has been given to Christ by his Father. Except, of course, Christ does not rule over the Father himself, who gave him this power to rule. When Christ has finally won the battle against all his enemies, then he, the Son of God, will put himself also under his Father's orders, so that God, who has given him the victory over everything else, will be utterly supreme. If the dead will not come back to life again, then what point is there in people being baptized for those who are gone? Why do it unless you believe that the dead will someday rise again? And why should we ourselves be continually risking our lives, facing death hour by hour? For it is a fact that I face death daily. That is as true as my pride in your growth in the Lord. And what value was there in fighting wild beasts, those men of Ephesus, if it was only for what I gain in this life down here? If we will never live again after we die, then we might as well go and have ourselves a good time. Let us eat, drink, and be merry. What's the difference? For tomorrow we die, and that ends everything. Don't be fooled by those who say such things. If you listen to them, you will start acting like them. Get some sense and quit your sinning. For to your shame, I say it, some of you are not even Christians at all and have never really known God. But someone may ask, how will the dead be brought back to life again? What kind of bodies will they have? What a foolish question. You will find the answer in your own garden. When you put a seed into the ground, it doesn't grow into a plant unless it dies first. And when the green shoot comes up out of the seed, it is very different from the seed you first planted. For all you put into the ground is a dry little seed of wheat or whatever it is you are planting. Then God gives it a beautiful new body, just the kind he wants it to have. A different kind of plant grows from each kind of seed. And just as there are different kinds of seeds and plants, so also there are different kinds of flesh. Humans, animals, fish, and birds are all different. The angels in heaven have bodies far different from ours, and the beauty and the glory of their bodies is different from the beauty and the glory of ours. The sun has one kind of glory, while the moon and stars have another kind. And the stars differ from each other in their beauty and brightness. In the same way, our earthly bodies which die and decay are different from the bodies we shall have when we come back to life again, for they will never die. The bodies we have now embarrass us, for they become sick and die. But they will be full of glory when we come back to life again. Yes, they are weak, dying bodies now, but when we live again, they will be full of strength. They are just human bodies at death. But when they come back to life, they will be superhuman bodies. For just as there are natural human bodies, there are also supernatural spiritual bodies. The scriptures tell us that the first man, Adam, was given a natural human body. But Christ is more than that, for he was life-giving spirit. First then, we have these human bodies. And later on, God gives us spiritual, heavenly bodies. Adam was made from the dust of the earth, but Christ came from heaven above. Every human being has a body just like Adam's, made of dust, but all who become Christ's will have the same kind of body as his, a body from heaven. Just as each of us now has a body like Adam's, so we shall someday have a body like Christ's. I tell you this, my brothers, an earthly body made of flesh and blood cannot get into God's kingdom. These perishable bodies of ours are not the right kind to live forever.
But I am telling you this strange and wonderful secret. We shall not all die, but we shall all be given new bodies. It will all happen in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, when the last trumpet is blown. For there will be a trumpet blast from the sky, and all the Christians who have died will suddenly become alive with new bodies that will never, never die. And then we who are still alive shall suddenly have new bodies too. For our earthly bodies, the ones we have now that can die, must be transformed into heavenly bodies that cannot perish but will live forever. When this happens, then at last this scripture will come true. Death is swallowed up in victory. Oh, death, where then your victory? Where then your sting? For sin, the sting that causes death, will all be gone, and the law which reveals our sins will no longer be our judge. How we thank God for all of this. It is He who makes us victorious through Jesus Christ our Lord. So, my dear brothers, since future victory is sure, be strong and steady, always abounding in the Lord's work. For you know that nothing you do for the Lord is ever wasted, as it would be if there were no resurrection.
Chapter 16.
Now, here are the directions about the money you are collecting to send to the Christians in Jerusalem. And by the way, these are the same directions I gave to the churches in Galatia. Every Sunday, each of you should put aside something from what you have earned during the week and use it for this offering. The amount depends on how much the Lord has helped you earn. Don't wait until I get there and then try to collect it all at once. When I come, I will send your loving gift with a letter to Jerusalem to be taken there by trustworthy messengers you yourselves will choose. And if it seems wise for me to go along too, then we can travel together. I am coming to visit you after I have been to Macedonia first, but I will be staying there only for a little while. It could be that I will stay longer with you, perhaps all winter, and then you can send me on to my next destination. This time I don't want to make just a passing visit and then go right on. I want to come and stay a while, if the Lord will let me. I will be staying here at Ephesus until the holiday of Pentecost, for there is a wide open door for me to preach and teach here. So much is happening, but there are many enemies. If Timothy comes, make him feel at home, for he is doing the Lord's work just as I am. Don't let anyone despise or ignore him because he is young, but send him back to me happy with his time among you. I am looking forward to seeing him soon, along with the others who are returning. I begged Apollos to visit you along with the others, but he thought that it was not at all God's will for him to go now. He will be seeing you later on when he has the opportunity. Keep your eyes open for spiritual danger. Stand true to the Lord. Act like men. Be strong. And whatever you do, do it with kindness and love. Do you remember Stephanas and his family? They were the first to become Christians in Greece, and they are spending their lives helping and serving Christians everywhere. Please follow their instructions and do everything you can to help them, as well as all others like them who work hard at your side with such real devotion. I am so glad that Stephanas, Fortunatus, and Achaicus have arrived here for a visit. They have been making up for the help you aren't here to give me. They have cheered me greatly and have been a wonderful encouragement to me, as I am sure they were to you too. I hope you properly appreciate the work of such men as these. The churches here in Asia send you their loving greetings. Aquila and Priscilla send you their love, and so do all the others who meet in their home for their church service. All the friends here have asked me to say hello to you for them and give each other a loving handshake when you meet. I will write these final words of this letter with my own hand. If anyone does not love the Lord, that person is cursed. Lord Jesus, come. May the love and favor of the Lord Jesus Christ rest upon you. My love to all of you, for we all belong to Christ Jesus. Sincerely, Paul.
Second Corinthians, chapter 1.
Dear friends, this letter is from me, Paul, appointed by God to be Jesus Christ's messenger, and from our dear brother Timothy. We are writing to all of you Christians there in Corinth and throughout Greece.
May God, our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ mightily bless each one of you and give you peace. What a wonderful God we have. He is the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the source of every mercy, and the one who so wonderfully comforts and strengthens us in our hardships and trials. And why does he do this? So that when others are troubled, needing our sympathy and encouragement, we can pass on to them this same help and comfort God has given us. You can be sure that the more we undergo sufferings for Christ, the more he will shower us with his comfort and encouragement. We are in deep trouble for bringing you God's comfort and salvation. But in our trouble, God had comforted us, and this too to help you, to show you from our personal experience how God will tenderly comfort you when you undergo these same sufferings. He will give you the strength to endure. I think you ought to know, dear brothers, about the hard time we went through in Asia. We were really crushed and overwhelmed and feared we would never live through it. We felt we were doomed to die and saw how powerless we were to help ourselves. But that was good, for then we put everything into the hands of God, who alone could save us, for he can even raise the dead. And he did help us and saved us from a terrible death. Yes, and we expect him to do it again and again. But you must help us too by praying for us. For much thanks and praise will go to God from you who see his wonderful answers to your prayers for our safety. We are so glad that we can say with utter honesty that in all our dealings we have been pure and sincere, quietly depending upon the Lord for his help and not on our own skills. And that is even more true, if possible, about the way we have acted toward you. My letters have been straightforward and sincere. Nothing is written between the lines. And even though you don't know me very well, I hope someday you will, I want you to try to accept me and be proud of me, as you already are to some extent, just as I shall be of you on that day when our Lord Jesus comes back again. It was because I was so sure of your understanding and trust that I planned to stop and see you on my way to Macedonia, as well as afterwards when I returned, so that I could be a double blessing to you, and so that you could send me on my way to Judea. Then why, you may be asking, did I change my plan? Hadn't I really made up my mind yet? Or am I like a man of the world who says yes when he really means no? Never. As surely as God is true, I am not that sort of person. My yes means yes. Timothy and Silvanus and I have been telling you about Jesus Christ, the Son of God. He isn't the one to say yes when he means no. He always does exactly what he says. He carries out and fulfills all of God's promises, no matter how many of them there are. And we have told everyone how faithful he is, giving glory to his name. It is this God who has made you and me into faithful Christians and commissioned us apostles to preach the good news. He has put his brand upon us, his mark of ownership, and given us his Holy Spirit in our hearts as guarantee that we belong to him and as the first installment of all that he is going to give us. I call upon this God to witness against me if I am not telling the absolute truth. The reason I haven't come to visit you yet is that I don't want to sadden you with a severe rebuke. When I come, although I can't do much to help your faith, for it is strong already, I want to be able to do something about your joy. I want to make you happy, not sad.
Chapter 2.
No, I said to myself, I won't do it. I'll not make them unhappy with another painful visit. For if I make you sad, who is going to make me happy? You are the ones to do it. And how can you if I cause you pain? That is why I wrote as I did in my last letter, so that you will get things straightened out before I come. Then when I do come, I will not be made sad by the very ones who ought to give me greatest joy. I felt sure that your happiness was so bound up in mine that you would not be happy either unless I came with joy. Oh, how I hated to write that letter. It almost broke my heart. And I tell you honestly that I cried over it. I didn't want to hurt you, but I had to show you how very much I loved you and cared about what was happening to you. Remember that the man I wrote about, who caused all the trouble, has not caused sorrow to me as much as to all the rest of you, though I certainly have my share in it, too. I don't want to be harder on him than I should. He has been punished enough by your united disapproval. Now it is time to forgive him and comfort him. Otherwise, he may become so bitter and discouraged that he won't be able to recover. Please show him now that you still do love him very much. I wrote to you as I did so that I could find out how far you would go in obeying me. When you forgive anyone, I do too. And whatever I have forgiven, to the extent that this affected me too, has been by Christ's authority and for your good. A further reason for forgiveness is to keep from being outsmarted by Satan, for we know what he is trying to do. Well, when I got as far as the city of Troas, the Lord gave me tremendous opportunities to preach the gospel. But Titus, my dear brother, wasn't there to meet me, and I couldn't rest, wondering where he was and what had happened to him. So I said goodbye and went right on to Macedonia to try to find him. But thanks be to God. For through what Christ has done, he has triumphed over us, so that now wherever we go, he uses us to tell others about the Lord and to spread the gospel like a sweet perfume. As far as God is concerned, there is a sweet, wholesome fragrance in our lives. It is the fragrance of Christ within us, an aroma to both the saved and the unsaved all around us. To those who are not being saved, we seem a fearful smell of death and doom, while to those who know Christ, we are a life-giving perfume. But who is adequate for such a task as this? Only those who, like ourselves, are men of integrity, sent by God, speaking with Christ's power, with God's eye upon us. We are not like those hucksters, and there are many of them, whose idea in getting out the gospel is to make a good living out of it.
Chapter 3.
Are we beginning to be like those false teachers of yours who must tell you all about themselves and bring long letters of recommendation with them? I think you hardly need someone's letter to tell you about us, do you? And we don't need a recommendation from you, either. The only letter I need is you yourselves. By looking at the good change in your hearts, everyone can see that we have done a good work among you. They can see that you are a letter from Christ, written by us. It is not a letter written with pen and ink, but by the Spirit of the living God. Not one carved on stone, but in human hearts. We dare to say these good things about ourselves only because of our great trust in God through Christ, that he will help us to be true to what we say. And not because we think we can do anything of lasting value by ourselves. Our only power and success comes from God. He is the one who has helped us tell others his new agreement to save them. We do not tell them that they must obey every law of God or die, but we tell them there is life for them from the Holy Spirit. The old way, trying to be saved by keeping the Ten Commandments, ends in death. In the new way, the Holy Spirit gives them life. Yet that old system of law that led to death began with such glory that people could not bear to look at Moses' face. For as he gave them God's law to obey, his face shone out with the very glory of God, though the brightness was already fading away. Shall we not expect far greater glory in these days when the Holy Spirit is giving life? If the plan that leads to doom was glorious, much more glorious is the plan that makes men right with God. In fact, that first glory, as it shone from Moses' face, is worth nothing at all in comparison with the overwhelming glory of the new agreement. So if the old system that faded into nothing was full of heavenly glory, the glory of God's new plan for our salvation is certainly far greater, for it is eternal. Since we know that this new glory will never go away, we can preach with great boldness, and not as Moses did, who put a veil over his face, so that the Israeli could not see the glory fade away. Not only Moses' face was veiled, but his people's minds and understanding were veiled and blinded too. Even now, when the scripture is read, it seems as though Jewish hearts and minds are covered by a thick veil, because they cannot see and understand the real meaning of the scriptures. For this veil of misunderstanding can be removed only by believing in Christ. Yes, even today when they read Moses' writings, their hearts are blind, and they think that obeying the Ten Commandments is the way to be saved. But whenever anyone turns to the Lord from his sins, then the veil is taken away.
The Lord is the Spirit who gives them life. And where He is, there is freedom from trying to be saved by keeping the laws of God. But we Christians have no veil over our faces. We can be mirrors that brightly reflect the glory of the Lord. And as the Spirit of the Lord works within us, we become more and more like Him.
Chapter 4.
It is God Himself in His mercy who has given us this wonderful work of telling His good news to others, and so we never give up. We do not try to trick people into believing. We are not interested in fooling anyone. We never try to get anyone to believe that the Bible teaches what it doesn't. All such shameful methods we forego. We stand in the presence of God as we speak, and so we tell the truth, as all who know us will agree. If the good news we preach is hidden to anyone, it is hidden from the one who is on the road to eternal death. Satan, who is the god of this evil world, has made him blind, unable to see the glorious light of the gospel that is shining upon him, or to understand the amazing message we preach about the glory of Christ, who is God. We don't go around preaching about ourselves, but about Christ Jesus as Lord. All we say of ourselves is that we are your slaves because of what Jesus has done for us. For God, who said, "Let there be light in the darkness," has made us understand that it is the brightness of His glory that is seen in the face of Jesus Christ. But this precious treasure, this light and power that now shine within us, is held in a perishable container, that is, in our own weak bodies. Everyone can see that the glorious power within must be from God and is not our own. We are pressed on every side by troubles, but not crushed and broken. We are perplexed because we don't know why things happen as they do, but we don't give up and quit. We are hunted down, but God never abandons us. We get knocked down, but we get up again and keep going. These bodies of ours are constantly facing death, just as Jesus did. So it is clear to all that it is only the living Christ within who keeps us safe. Yes, we live under constant danger to our lives because we serve the Lord. But this gives us constant opportunities to show forth the power of Jesus Christ within our dying bodies. Because of our preaching, we face death, but it has resulted in eternal life for you. We boldly say what we believe, trusting God to care for us, just as the psalm writer did when he said, "I believe, and therefore I speak." We know that the same God who brought the Lord Jesus back from death will also bring us back to life again with Jesus and present us to Him along with you. These sufferings of ours are for your benefit. And the more of you who are one to Christ, the more there are to thank Him for His great kindness, and the more the Lord is glorified. That is why we never give up. Though our bodies are dying, our inner strength in the Lord is growing every day. These troubles and sufferings of ours are, after all, quite small and won't last very long. Yet this short time of distress will result in God's richest blessing upon us forever and ever. So we do not look at what we can see right now, the troubles all around us, but we look forward to the joys in heaven which we have not yet seen. The troubles will soon be over, but the joys to come will last forever.
Chapter 5.
For we know that when this tent we live in now is taken down, when we die and leave these bodies, we will have wonderful new bodies in heaven, homes that will be ours forevermore, made for us by God Himself and not by human hands. How weary we grow of our present bodies. That is why we look forward eagerly to the day when we shall have heavenly bodies, which we shall put on like new clothes. For we shall not be merely spirits without bodies. These earthly bodies make us groan and sigh, but we wouldn't like to think of dying and having no bodies at all. We want to slip into our new bodies so that these dying bodies will, as it were, be swallowed up by everlasting life. This is what God has prepared for us, and as a guarantee, He has given us His Holy Spirit. Now we look forward with confidence to our heavenly bodies, realizing that every moment we spend in these earthly bodies is time spent away from our eternal home in heaven with Jesus. We know these things are true by believing, not by seeing. And we are not afraid, but are quite content to die, for then we shall be at home with the Lord. So our aim is to please him always in everything we do, whether we are here in this body or away from this body and with him in heaven. For we must all stand before Christ to be judged and have our lives laid bare before him. Each of us will receive whatever he deserves for the good or bad things he has done in his earthly body. It is because of this solemn fear of the Lord, which is ever present in our minds, that we work so hard to win others. God knows our hearts, that they are pure in this matter, and I hope that deep within you really know it too. Are we trying to pat ourselves on the back again? No. I am giving you some good ammunition. You can use this on those preachers of yours who brag about how well they look and preach, but don't have true and honest hearts. You can boast about us that we, at least, are well-intentioned and honest. Are we insane to say such things about ourselves? If so, it is to bring glory to God. And if we are in our right minds, it is for your benefit. Whatever we do, it is certainly not for our own profit, but because Christ's love controls us now. Since we believe that Christ died for all of us, we should also believe that we have died to the old life we used to live. He died for all, so that all who live, having received eternal life from him, might live no longer for themselves, to please themselves, but to spend their lives pleasing Christ who died and rose again for them. So stop evaluating Christians by what the world thinks about them, or by what they seem to be like on the outside. Once I mistakenly thought of Christ that way, merely as a human being like myself. How differently I feel now. When someone becomes a Christian, he becomes a brand new person inside. He is not the same anymore. A new life has begun. All these new things are from God, who brought us back to himself through what Christ Jesus did. And God has given us the privilege of urging everyone to come into his favor and be reconciled to him. For God was in Christ, restoring the world to himself, no longer counting men's sins against them, but blotting them out. This is the wonderful message he has given us to tell others. We are Christ's ambassadors. God is using us to speak to you. We beg you, as though Christ himself were here pleading with you, receive the love he offers you. Be reconciled to God. For God took the sinless Christ and poured into him our sins. Then, in exchange, he poured God's goodness into us.
Chapter 6.
As God's partners, we beg you not to toss aside this marvelous message of God's great kindness. For God says, "Your cry came to me at a favorable time, when the doors of welcome were wide open. I helped you on a day when salvation was being offered." Right now, God is ready to welcome you. Today, he is ready to save you. We try to live in such a way that no one will ever be offended or kept back from finding the Lord by the way we act, so that no one can find fault with us and blame it on the Lord. In fact, in everything we do, we try to show that we are true ministers of God. We patiently endure suffering and hardship and trouble of every kind. We have been beaten, put in jail, faced angry mobs, worked to exhaustion, stayed awake through sleepless nights of watching, and gone without food. We have proved ourselves to be what we claim by our wholesome lives and by our understanding of the gospel and by our patience. We have been kind and truly loving and filled with the Holy Spirit. We have been truthful, with God's power helping us in all we do. All of the godly man's arsenal, weapons of defense and weapons of attack, have been ours. We stand true to the Lord, whether others honor us or despise us, whether they criticize us or commend us. We are honest, but they call us liars.